as a technical writer. It's been almost a decade that I have been working as an information engineer, as a writer, and my journey began back there in my hometown, New Delhi. I come from India, and Sweden is treating me really well. So this is my second job here. Prior to this, I was working at Tecton Design Systems, so the same today. And today I just want to present the 6 C's of technical writing, which are, I think, very basic. I'm not sure who all among here are familiar, or I think you must be. Any random guesses?
One C actually is in connection with what Lindy mentioned, concise, I think.
Clean.
You know, I have more answers, like what am I going to talk about? Is this a bit, it's the basic foundation on which the technical writing stands. So you can also refer these C's as the pillars of technical writing, or writing, or communication in general. So consistent.
Clarity.
Content.
Consumer.
Communication.
Yeah, I'm getting a lot of
crazy.
So I believe that all the work and processes, whatever is done in any particular company, it is just behind the doors, and information engineers and tech writers are those guys who, with the help of these tools, the 6 C's, bring forward that hidden information, those processes. So technical writing is the face value of any company. So with that, I present to you the first C, which is clear. So this relates to clarity of the content, information, and it particularly relates to what. Like, what is the information about? What are you talking? And we as technical writers, in the first step of document design life cycle, we go in the requirement gathering stage and we ask the developers, what do you expect from us? And that's the point where they give us information and present the what. For example, now I'm working with a client and they have a wide scope of work and processes. So they have 4 manuals: operators, service, programming, and software. So my first question to the developer is that this content that you're giving to me, clarify the content, where shall it go? What is the information about? That's the first C. Second, indeed, we need to ask them, or probably make the content correct ourselves. And that's where requirement analysis stage begins, after requirement gathering. Because unless and until you make the content correct, meaningless. So as a technical writer, my job is to ensure that I do not put any misleading information out there that probably leads to injuries, probably with people working as service engineers on fields, or workers in factories, people who are reading the installation guides and programming manuals. So what I'm presenting to them must be very correct. So we asked the development team that, is the information accurate? That also involves technical reviews. So whenever I get information, I do the first draft and I send it out to the team of developers and SMEs, other subject matter experts. Then they come to me that, okay, this part is correct, and this is not relevant. The third C is comprehensible. So if I, of course, like technical writing involves a lot of jargons and technical content and really mind-blowing, crazy words, but if I put out all of them in a very complicated manner, then the target audience will not be able to understand that. And that's where I ensure that the English language is really understandable. Right now I'm working with something called STE. I'm not sure how many of you are aware of Standard Technical English. Anybody here? So it's, I think then we can relate how crazy it is. So we as technical writers, we ensure that the content is absolutely clear and understandable to the audience perception. And then they get to do the processes absolutely in the designed way. So I asked the question, is information easily understandable? And I put this question to myself after I had done my first draft. So that makes my job really easy. The fourth C, completeness of the content. So for example, I have to draft a process of putting a card. You can say, take any machine, a card reader, and a card goes into a scanner. There is a board. I insert the card, and it does its job, and then it comes out. So all this while, I need to draft all these steps and probably break them down into chunks of information and then analyze that all these stages will highlight the importance of information in a way that this might go to, the first set of information might go to programming manual, the next set might go to software manual, and again, a part of the common analysis. So that's where the completeness of content matters a lot. So am I giving the audience complete information, or am I leaving them with half steps, and then they don't know where to begin and where to stop? And I ask myself, is any important part missing from the information? And if I have any doubt, I approach the development team. And as my dear friend said, the conciseness of the content really matters. Exactly. And that's where infographics come into picture, that's where bullets come into picture, and that's where STE comes into picture, where we take away all the irrelevant words that are not required, and we streamline the content according to usability. So conciseness does matter, and in my journey I've also learned that it's not only about documentation. These days, translation is a very important domain in alignment with the documentation business, because when you translate like 100 words, it definitely increases the cost of business. So we definitely save a lot by making the content smaller and concise and meaningful. So, is information well expressed in lesser words? That's the fifth C. And the next and the last one is consistency. When I'm designing content, I make sure, as a technical writer, that all my content adheres to the same font, to the same style and formatting, that I do not alienate or keep my content hanging up there somewhere in some strange font, and then I begin with another style. So that's where consistency matters. And I think this is the most important C in the six C's, but this is the golden thread which is tying your content from A to Z. It is the C which is integrating and making your content more meaningful, giving it a purpose, that where the information begins and where it ends. So I think consistency really matters, that what are you talking about? Are you deviating in between or misleading? Or so consistency really matters. And I ask myself a question, is information well aligned and purposeful from the beginning till the end? For example, if I'm just writing about troubleshooting, then I'm very much focused that I present to the user, to my target audience, only about troubleshooting steps. I'm not telling him I'm not guiding him to the steps after troubleshooting or prior to that or maybe another processes. So I'm just focused on one particular area and concentrating only on that domain. So here is some sample content of STE verified content. And it's about the capacitors, which I recently did. And it begins with the information that how a capacitor is specified at a certain voltage, what are the results. So this is a perfect example of all the six C's that I just mentioned. But then I have a question for you at the end, so you may go through it slow and steady. And we also have, should I move to the next talk slide? Mm-hmm. That's how it ends, because it's telling about the capacitors and also including the notes for the user. So, this is the content, but I want to ask you, probably there's something more that could be done with this content, and if someone could figure out, because probably if you could notice little elements, what I'm trying to say is probably we can enhance this content by adding one small thing which is missing. Otherwise the content is
Some headings maybe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Heading is, that's a sample content, so yeah, good point. But one more guess, one more thing, yeah.
Illustration?
Maybe, yes. But I'm just focusing on the content. I'm not focusing on illustration or anything, because there are particular.
And maybe put it on a table.
Okay, so I'll tell you. So you do see some units of measurements. That is microfarad, which is the unit of capacitor. And so as we saw in the previous slide, some voltage. AC for alternating current. So what I'm trying to say here is keywords are also very important. The glossary is super important, and that also is a part of completeness. Because if you just present the audience the correct information with the right steps, with the right notes, everything, but then you do not tell them probably what does AC stand for? I mean, of course, I've taken a chunk of information, but when we are presenting all this information, manual, we ensure that in that manual we do have appendixes, we do have glossaries that cover all these paths, these little tiny little elements which we call as keywords. And we provide the abbreviations and acronyms. So that's also a super important part of good technical writing.
How do you ensure that your content is accurate? You mentioned what you're working on currently could actually, you know, somebody could get injured if it's incorrect. I luckily work with a software that serves ads, so nobody will die. But it has happened numerous times that I write documentation, it gets reviewed by engineers or product owners, and still they forget to mention something, and then in a few months somebody files a bug. And it's like, engineers go, but that's by design, we knew about that. I'm like, why didn't you tell me? So obviously they don't remember always, and I can't ensure it's correct always in that way. So how do you do it?
I think that's a responsibility of both the parties. I strongly believe with you, and that's where I make an extra effort and be responsible for, because now I'm working with hardware. And the journey was not so easy because back then I was working, and I had been working with software, but recently my project involves hardware machines, and a person got injured, and that was serious. And can you believe that? Why it happened? It was just due to one stupid label or a disclaimer which did not mention that there was a hood. So they were printing something, and then there was a hood which could bend down the latch, and the note said something else. Instead of the latch, the note pointed onto the top of the machine. So that was an error, that was a disastrous error, I think. And we were immediately informed that a guy has been injured, immediately removed this disclaimer from the manuals, and remove and replace the word latch with hood, or like, and then we corrected that. So I think it's really important for the writer to go to all the demos and get connected with the engineers and probably understand the product or service or the process, whatever you're working with, like A to Z. I know, like, we cannot step into the shoes of developers, but it's quite challenging, difficult. But still, I think sometimes we have to push our boundaries and get to know the process exactly from their mindset and their perception. That what the hell is going on there? I mean, just ensure if nobody gets injured, or especially at companies like who are dealing with hardware, and just be mindful at every step to grab the right information. I mean, we need to chase them, because they will probably not come and give the information in our lab. So that's our tough part, to chase them and get out the information.
Do you do verification?
Sorry?
Do you guys do verification on the
mm-hmm. In what sense? What do you mean?
Like, because you said, like, the engineer said it came by design, but then actually the customer filed that, right?
Yep.
So they couldn't have it work. They couldn't
it's
have
not
it
that
work.
It doesn't work. It's like, it's a minor bug that somebody found that doesn't affect everyone.
Uh-huh.
And it's really hard to figure out if you're testing. I always test the UI, I always use the APIs, you know, the things that I can think of, I test them, and I trust in the automated tests that
mm-hmm.
the engineers do and everything. But there's always something, you know, each
mm-hmm.
customer uses the software in a different way.
Yeah.
And you can't think of everything. And they think it's, I don't know, engineers either think, oh, it's implied or obvious, so all they figure it on their own or something,
yeah.
Or they just don't think about mentioning it in the documentation process, and it gets forgotten. But for me, it's easier. Like, I can at least use the software, but surely you never went under that hood and you couldn't know that that was wrong, right? So I'm thinking, in those cases, how do you really can tell if it's accurate or not in advance?
I mean, you just need to dig out information one after another and just ensure that, especially ensure in the cases of disclaimers and warnings and cautions, that are these cautions presented in the correct manner? Do they really belong to that particular set of audience or process? Or if not, where else should I put them? So that's where we need to run our extra mind, and there's a lot of effort.
Can you talk a bit more about standard technical English? Do you use tools for that or services? Like, how do you comply with that?
So I'm super glad I'll soon be having a training on that in April. So far, we have introduced how to use English in context with industry or companies that are using probably some certain kind of equipment, probably aerospace industries, and it's really concentrated style of using English, because in a layman terms, I would say it's a very kiddish, it's a baby English, because in general life, like day to day, we do not use such English, and it's your head sometimes that what am I writing in there, but it's done because our documents are translated into 16 different languages, and so that, for example, I'll just give you an example. According to is not used. You cannot use the word according to in documentation. You need to substitute the word like fit. Fit can be used as a noun, not as a verb. So there are certain, there are a list of words that can be used as verbs or nouns or adjectives. And we really have to dig down deep into the documentation and search for all these words and replace them or change the content so that they get easily translated later and the translation team doesn't have any issues. But at the same time, many times I have not arguments, but the SMEs, the developers, are not happy with the content because they said, now you have changed the meaning. Now you have taken away these words
office is super secure. It's going to be a long every hour to talk about.
So, we use STD for managing all such issues for specific industries.
Sorry,
that was
the alarm. It goes off every hour. You have to
make sure
to turn it off.
We have a manual. We have 200 plus pages book which we have to memorize. Like, I'm still working on it. What words are allowed? What are not allowed? So that I design my content accordingly, and it's quite challenging.
But there is a software. A plugin for that can be used in many editors.
I think we are not unfortunately using that. We are seeking more help. Well, we have a manual editor, and he's a super nice guy, Per Ben said. So whenever we are stuck, we send our documents to him, and he's the chief editor of our company. So he checks it out, and but I'm glad that we have learned a lot, in our team. Of technical writing, we have really learned the style of STE, which is challenging, but it's really interesting. I mean, you gain interest slow and steady as you move forward and take the irrelevant content out.
But do you always follow it? Isn't that there's room? It's not set in stone.
We have to, as per the company rules where we are working, as per the client rules, we are there to provide them STE documented manuals. And even if it's a two-liner note or disclaimer, it has to be STE proved. So that adds on more responsibility for writers.
I'd say by using STE, you clarify that the matches always get through. Mm. If you have a jet fighter going Mach 2, you want to be dead sure the information that is passed on to the pilot is accurate and just the right message.
Exactly.
I know some writers that they think that it's too simple, as a simplified. It's like,
do they define it simple?
Yeah, like too simple sometimes.
No, I mean, implementing is not simple, I would say. But of course, the content does become simple. That's why I simplify technical English.
Uh-huh.
But again, it's done so that there is no injury.
Mm.
People really follow the process and the steps as mentioned. And like, for example, the word following is not allowed. That, you know, just like see the instructions, like see the following instructions. So instead of that, I write see, not even see. Obey the instructions as follows. So it's like they are very like orderly and quite like legal words there. So now I've learned a lot. Yes.
May I, like, because you mentioned that the simplified technical English is mostly used in industrial areas, for example, like aerospace. So may I understand, because based on your introduction of those vocabularies, it sounds like commands, like computer commands. So basically it's like the simplest word that can be used to actually accomplish that action.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. So we're actually treating the other type of human beings.
Yes. It's also because it's heavy,
yes,
heavy machinery,
mm-hmm,
and that we are dealing with, and we, like, no jokes there. We have to be very serious about the commands and processes and steps. Like, even a simple mistake of a comma or a simple word like given. Given is not allowed. Like, given the name, like the given name, so the word given is not allowed. Many certain names, many simple words are not allowed. So that confusion does not arise, so that the engineers who are reading them, and they just follow it, and it gets translated easily in all the languages. So that's the main difference.
And one more from me, if I may. So can you supply the text with pictures or diagrams or something else but text in this restricted environment? And do you have any restrictions of what kind of illustrative material you supply your text
with? Yeah, we do have. We are only supposed to provide illustrations and not pictures. So we have a team and we divide our work. So people go and take the pictures, and then those pictures are translated into the illustrations using Adobe, and then we use those with our instructions in the manuals. So mostly pictures are not allowed, and like they're like, but I think these rules are like very client specific, and I'm glad that we are meeting their requirements and expectations and following all the rules of STE very nicely.
If we have more questions, we can ask offline. You will stay here.
Yeah, I work here. I don't have my details, but you can always probably, I don't know, search on Combitech portal and with my name. or search for me on LinkedIn. So I'm always there on LinkedIn.
Yeah.
So. Okay, talk.